Welcome to Salem Covenant Church as we gather for our traditional worship service. I'm Pastor Mark Patty and want to continue to encourage you to be connecting with us and with God through our website, our Facebook page, and here on our YouTube channel. If you haven't already subscribed to our YouTube channel, I'd encourage you to do so so that you can take advantage of the many offerings that we have popping up every day. Salem is going to be offering a vacation Bible school this summer. It's a virtual VBS from June 22nd through the 26th, and the title of it is Focus, Take a Closer Look. Focus VBS will help kids dive deeper into their faith. Kids will have a blast as they discover how to trust in what they can't see because of what they can see by putting their focus on God and His amazing plans for us. This online opportunity is for children of all ages and is being offered this year by Salem for free. And so I encourage you to go ahead and register today on Salem's website or through our app. I want to thank the many of you who continue to be involved in supporting efforts to bring about justice and peace, to combat racism and bring about a more just world for all people. Those of you who have been bringing food and needed goods for those who are especially at risk because of the violence that has taken place. We've posted a number of initiatives with regard to Love, Mercy, Do Justice on Salem's website and our Facebook page. And we're continuing to develop these as we go along. I encourage you to look to our Facebook page, our website, for those opportunities. They include, even this week, opportunities for prayer and lament, intercession, for learning and growth, for discussion. So I encourage you to go ahead and take advantage of those opportunities. I want to thank those who are assisting in our worship service today. Pastor John Afont, who will be assisting, Sarah and Kent Whitworth, who will be leading us in prayer and reading scripture, Cindy Rentz, our music coordinator and organist, our soloist, Jen Wallace, who, along with Greg Grimes and John and Rachel Venker, will be leading us in our hymns. This is the second Sunday after Pentecost, and it's also informally known as Children's Sunday, a day we especially celebrate our kids. Let us worship the Lord.
Please join me for the call to worship by reading with me responsively the lines that are in bold. Make a joyful noise to the Lord, all the earth. Worship the Lord with gladness. Come into his presence with singing. Know that the Lord is God. It is he that made us, and we are his. We are his people and the sheep of his pasture. Enter his gates with thanksgiving and his courts with praise. Give thanks to him. Bless his name. For the Lord is good. His steadfast love endures forever, and his faithfulness to all generations.
Join in the prayer of invocation. Almighty God, you have created and called us to be your people, the sheep of your pasture. To you we lift up our praise. As you sent Jesus to redeem us and lead us on right paths for your name's sake, so send your Spirit to enable us to follow him in loving faithfulness, serving you and our neighbors to the glory of your name. Amen. This morning's Old Testament reading comes from the book of Genesis, chapter 18, verses 1 through 15. The Lord appeared to Abraham by the oaks of Mamre, as he sat at the entrance of his tent in the heat of the day. He looked up and saw three men standing near him. When he saw them, he ran from the tent entrance to meet them and bowed down to the ground. He said, "My Lord, if I find favor with you, do not pass by your servant. Let a little water be brought, and wash your feet, and rest yourselves under the tree. Let me bring a little bread, that you may refresh yourselves, and after that you may pass on, since you have come to your servant." So they said, "Do as you have said." And Abraham hastened into the tent to Sarah and said, "Make ready quickly three measures of choice flour, knead it, and make cakes." Abraham ran to the herd and took a calf, tender and good, and gave it to the servant, who hastened to prepare it. Then he took curds and milk and the calf that he had prepared and set it before them, and he stood by them under the tree while they ate. They said to him, "Where is your wife Sarah?" And he said, "There, in the tent." Then one said, "I will surely return to you in due season, and your wife Sarah shall have a son." And Sarah was listening at the tent entrance behind him. Now Abraham and Sarah were old, advanced in age. It had ceased to be with Sarah after the manner of women. So Sarah laughed to herself, saying, "After I have grown old and my husband is old, shall I have pleasure?" The Lord said to Abraham, "Why did Sarah laugh and say, 'Shall I indeed bear a child now that I am old?' Is anything too wonderful for the Lord? At the set time, I will return to you in due season, and Sarah shall have a son." But Sarah denied, saying, "I did not laugh," for she was afraid. He said, "Oh, yes, you did laugh."
This morning's New Testament reading comes from the book of Romans, chapter 5, verses 1 through 8. "Therefore, since we are justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have obtained access to this grace in which we stand, and we boast in our hope of sharing the glory of God. And not only that, but that we boast in our sufferings, knowing that suffering produces endurance, and endurance produces character, and character produces hope, and hope does not disappoint us, because God's love has been poured into our hearts through the Holy Spirit that has been given to us. For while we were still weak, at the right time, Christ died for the ungodly. Indeed, rarely will anyone die for a righteous person, though perhaps for a good person, someone might actually dare to die. But God proves his love for us, for in that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. The grass withers, the flower fades, but the word of our God will stand forever.
Beauty.
thank you for joining us in worship wherever you are. It's so great to connect with you. Salem continues to make plans and move toward reopening our doors as safely as we can. It's exciting as our city begins to allow for more connection with each other. We dream of the day when we will be able to gather together physically. I want to thank you for not waiting to be the church until then. Thank you for your faithful prayers for one another. Thank you for your phone calls, deliveries, and visits to one another. And thanks for continuing to engage online with the programs the church is offering for all ages, just like this worship service. In the months and years to come, we will reflect on this time of disruption and isolation. We're going to tell some more stories, and we're going to tell some stories of grace. I think we will value each other in some new ways, and I have a feeling that we will understand the preciousness of what we have in each other more deeply. Thanks for the very tangible ways you are counting Salem as precious in your giving. Our finances continue to be strong as we bring the fiscal year to an end at the end of this month. If you would like to give, you can do so through the Salem app. You can do so on our website at salem-covenant.church. And you can mail in your check just to the church address. May God bless you as you worship. Let's pray. Our God, who is Lord, we worship you this morning with thanksgiving. You continue to be worthy of all our praise, worthy of all our hope, and worthy of all our love. You are good, and your goodness prevails and endures. Our world feels so shaken and fallen. The pandemic and racial injustice have weakened our institutions and structures until they feel thin and fragile. We know that peace, health, and human dignity are gifts given by your hand and cannot be assumed. We pray that we would be able to receive these gifts at greater and greater capacity. Help our society to emerge stronger and more righteous from this upheaval. Let people hear of your goodness and put their hope, trust, and faith in you. Thank you for your death and resurrection that makes this all attainable because of the great power at work in us through your Holy Spirit. Hear us now as we pray in faith and hope and love together the prayer that Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Today we continue our sermon series, When God Seems Silent. Last week we talked about how there are these times in our own personal lives, maybe in the societal life, when we're just, where's God in the midst of all that's happening? I'm not hearing God. And we talked about how when we aren't feeling like we're hearing God, that we need to remember God has spoken. There's plenty that we already know. As we looked at Matthew chapter 28, verses 16 through 20, we heard Jesus command that we go out into the world making disciples, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, and teaching them, beginning with us, to obey everything that Jesus has commanded us. And of course, that includes Matthew 5 through 7, the Sermon on the Mount, That includes loving God with all of our heart, soul, mind, and strength, our neighbor as ourself, out of which all the rest of the laws flow. It includes Micah 6:8. He's told you, O mortal, what is good, and what does the Lord require of you but to do justice, to love kindness, to walk humbly with your God. We've already got plenty that God has said. If we would do that, maybe God would speak even more to us, but he's told us plenty. We need actually to be obedient. That passage, of course, Matthew 28, ends with Jesus saying, I'll be with you always, wherever you go, you know, to the end of the age. And that reminds me of Exodus chapter 3, where we hear God speaking to Moses out of that burning bush. You might remember he calls Moses to go back and to bring the people out of Israel or out of Egypt, and God, and Moses says, who am I? And then his next question is going to be, who are you? Who should I say sent me? And God says to him, tell them I am who I am. Or another way of translating that is, I will be there as I will be there. In other words, God is always there. God will show up. But God's going to show up as God will show up. And one of the big problems for religion, including the Christian religion, as we become religious, when we try to codify it, is we try to put God in a box so that God will show up as we want God to show up, so that our expectations of what God will do and what God can say are within a limit that we are comfortable with. And anytime we get to this place where our religion is an attempt to get God to dance for us, to do for us what we think God should do, rather than us being open to God coming to us as God chooses, God getting us to do what God created us for, we get into trouble. We start to limit God, which of course we can't do, but in turn begin limiting ourselves. So as we're talking right now about, you know, when God seems silent, part of what is happening is not that God has changed or God is not speaking, but that maybe we aren't open to God coming to us as God chooses to come to us. Maybe we're not listening to God as God wants to speak to us. We're too caught up in expecting God to come in certain ways, to say what we expect, want God to say. It makes me think of the Gospel of Matthew chapter 9, just before today's gospel lesson, where Jesus has raised a girl from the dead. He's healed a woman who's been bleeding. He's healed two blind men, given them sight. And just before today's passage starts, he's cast out a demon that has kept this man mute. He's not been able to speak. And Jesus casts out that demon and allows him to find his voice, to have voice again. And the Pharisees, the religious leaders, they try to just kind of dismiss all of this movement of God in their world by saying, he's casting out demons by the ruler of demons. Yeah, it makes me think of what we do when God's on the move in our world, in our lives, when God's speaking to us words we aren't sure we want to hear. How do we go about dismissing God's word, closing our ears, our eyes to what God is saying and doing? Even today in our world, no question, God is on the move here in our nation and even here in the Twin Cities. We may not like everything that's happening, and maybe not everything that's happening is good, but you can be sure God's on the move. You can be sure that as people are finding their voices, that may well be the casting off of demons that have been keeping them silent for so long. It might be that we should consider being a part of enabling people to speak up, to have voice in our society. it might be that God's on the move and we need to join in. And so I invite you right now, as we struggle to hear God's voice in the midst of all that's going on, especially with, for me, there are so many voices, and I struggle as we listen to the voices about the pandemic and how to deal with that, or about racism and how to deal with that. How do we listen for God's voice amid all that cacophony? As we read today's passage, gospel lesson from Matthew 9, beginning in verse 35, I invite you to chew on that. Listen for that. What is God saying to you, to us, about how to hear his voice in the midst of all that's going on? Then Jesus went about all the cities and villages, teaching in their synagogues and proclaiming the good news of the kingdom and curing every disease and every sickness. When he saw the crowds, he had compassion for them, because they were harassed and helpless like sheep without a shepherd. Then he said to his disciples, "The harvest is plentiful, but the laborers are few. Therefore ask the Lord of the harvest to send out laborers into his harvest." Then Jesus summoned his 12 disciples and gave them authority over unclean spirits to cast them out and to cure every disease and every sickness. These are the names of the 12 apostles: first Simon, also known as Peter, and his brother Andrew; James, son of Zebedee, and his brother John; Philip and Bartholomew; Thomas and Matthew, the tax collector; James, son of Alphaeus and Thaddeus; Simon the Cananean; and Judas Iscariot, the one who betrayed him. These 12 Jesus sent out with the following instructions: "Go nowhere among the Gentiles, and enter no town of the Samaritans, but go rather to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. As you go, proclaim the good news. The kingdom of heaven has come near. Cure the sick, raise the dead, cleanse the lepers, cast out demons. You received without payment, give without payment." The word of the Lord. So when God's on the move, and we know God is on the move, how do we attend to his presence? How do we hear his voice amid all that's being said and amid the fears and anxieties within ourselves that often, whether we want to admit it or not, keep our ears from hearing? Looking at this passage, it's clear that the place to start is with the heart. When we want to listen for God's voice, the place to start is by listening to God's heart. What is it in the midst of all we're hearing, the options and possibilities, the steps ahead, what we're seeing, where is it that God's heart is coming through? Jesus sees the crowds and he has compassion for them. We know that this is the heart of God, this heart of love. And so as we think about what God is concerned for, what God might be speaking to us about, what God wants to accomplish in our world, we can be sure that love's going to be at the heart of that. And anything God has for us is going to be a word of love for us and a word of love through us to the world. And there's a book called Reframation, which is a really interesting read about trying to gain perspective in the midst of all that's going on right now. It's written by Alan Hirsch and Mark Nelson. One of the things that they say in there is that if you want to change something, you've got to love it first. I don't know that that's true for everything universally, but it's certainly true when it comes to God's work in the world. That if we want to be a part of God's work, his kingdom breaking into this world, then we've got to love this world first. We've got to love the crowds first. Maybe like me, when you look at all the tumult that's been happening, you find fear being one of the emotions that comes across also. And there are times for fear, for that to be a reality, for us to be aware that fear is not inappropriate given some of what's been happening. But as people of God, we've got to know that God loves the crowds, the individuals in the crowds, that it's not okay for us just to paint everybody with some brush and then cast them off, dismiss them, dismiss God's love for them, dismiss what God wants to do. You've got to understand that each one of these people has a story, that God knows the hairs on their head one by one, and that God has compassion and is calling us to have compassion, to share in that compassion for others. If we want to change the world, we've got to start by praying that God would help us to love our neighbors as ourselves. Yeah, I think of what Jesus now invites his disciples to do. After we hear of his compassion, he then invites his disciples to start praying for God to send out laborers into this harvest. Jesus sees it not just as a troubled world, but as a place of opportunity. There's opportunity for us to be a part of God's kingdom breaking in among the crowds, among the needy, among those who are oppressed by the demons of our world. And God wants us to be a part of that, to pray for people to go out and to be a part of that. And as we pray, we find that our hearts begin to become aligned with God's heart. And this is so important. This is why Jesus calls us to pray for our enemies, is so that our hearts become aligned with God's heart, the one who cares, who loves for each person he's created on this planet. And we can begin to minimize the reach, the mission of the church sometimes, just as we can try to reduce God to acting the way we want God to act or saying what we want God to say. We can reduce what we're going to do to the ministry, the mission to which God is calling us. In that book, Reframation, they quote a friend of theirs, and I just love these lines. He says, as they talk about how we're sometimes reducing the mission that God's called us to, their friend Brad Briscoe states, "We've reduced the church to a place and a gathering. We have reduced mission to evangelism. We have reduced worship to singing songs. We have reduced the gospel to bullet points. We have reduced Christology to the cross. We have reduced discipleship to the transfer of information." And he goes on, you know, that God is calling us, first of all, to recognize the compassion God has, to listen for his word that will come out of that compassion, to pray that our hearts would be aligned with the compassion of God in the world. And then, as this book and others are encouraging us to do, to hear God's word, that we go as a part of the answer to these prayers we have for our world, these prayers Jesus has for those who are in need. And so the question for us as we listen for God's voice, as we start with the heart of God, is what is God calling us to do as we venture forward as his disciples, his apostles, those who are sent into the world? How is it that we can be a part of proclaiming the good news and being a part of the good news, that the kingdom of heaven has come near, that God is on the move in our world, and we want to be a part of that? I'm so thrilled, so delighted to see in the midst of the chaos that's going on in so many ways, people joining in with the movement of God in our world, being a part of care and compassion, of justice and of opportunity being given to the people of our society, of our world, including those who have been given the least opportunity too often. By God's grace, may we venture forward, listening for the voice of God, listening for the heart of God, and sharing in this work of God's heart in the world. Let's pray together. God, we thank you for your compassionate heart, that while we were yet sinners, while we were yet separated from you, while we were yet your enemies, you loved us and died for us. And you have called us to be a part of your loving work in the world. We confess to you, Lord, that we're scared of it, that we're afraid of things being turned upside down, that we're not sure where this journey leads. But we commit ourselves today to following you in faith, to going as you have sent us, and being a part of your great work in the world. Not because we are so great ourselves, but because you have called us and you are sending us. Forward we go. In Jesus' name, amen. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you now and forever. Amen.